Welcome to the second session in the webinar series, Care of Diverse Elders and Their Families in Primary Care, sponsored by the Stanford Geriatric Education Center in collaboration with the California Area Health Education Centers, American Geriatric Society, and Natividad Medical Center. My name is Chris Matola, and I will be your host for this session. We are very happy to have you join with us today as we present the program on diabetes. If you have questions during the presentation, please use the chat feature on the screen to write them. The presenters will respond to the questions in a Q&A session at the end of their presentation. If you need to communicate with the presenters directly after the session, you may do so by sending an email to stanfordgec@stanford.edu. At the conclusion of the webinar, please complete the short evaluation questionnaire. For those of you who have requested continuing education credits for attending the webinar, the evaluation is required. We need to let you know that the webinar is not supported by any commercial interest, and today's presenters have no financial relationships to disclose. The presentation is being presented by Nancy Morioka-Douglas and Sonia Alvarez. And now for the presentation.
Diabetes occurs more often in African American, Latino, and American Indian elders. Asian American elders have about the same prevalence as white American elders. I highlighted the self-reported fair or poor health row so that you could see that the self-reported fair or poor health prevalence is very much the same as the prevalence of diabetes. This is another slide that just shows you that diabetes is more prevalent, as well as new cases are more common among elders who are black, which is the black row, Hispanic, which is the red row, compared to the green row, which are white elder Americans. However, when you look at mortality, you can see that non-Hispanic blacks have about the same mortality from diabetes as non-Hispanic whites in the Medicare population. And we see that there is really not that much difference for this particular older population. That to me means that when you think about ethnic elders and diabetes, you really are talking about morbidity associated with the disease, those complications that affect quality of life, like being able to see, how your kidneys are functioning, and ambulation. Here we can see that not only do we have different cultural approaches to different cohorts, but in fact there is a different belief about what constitutes obesity as you look across different countries. For Canada and the U.S., you can see that the recommended waist circumference for males is 102 centimeters or about 40 inches, and in women less at 88 centimeters or about 36 inches. Look down at, for example, the Japanese Obesity Society definition, which is much less for males, and interestingly, a little bit more for females. So again, from this, you get a sense that diabetes, or at least truncal obesity, which is a strong predictor for type 2 diabetes, the very definition may vary across cultures and countries. Let's start by looking at the statistics with regard to diabetes in African American elders. In general, African Americans are twice as likely to have diabetes. The highest incidence is in the elderly between 65 to 75. Across the whole population, they're more likely to be hospitalized and they're more likely to die. African American women are more likely to be diagnosed than non-Hispanic whites, African American men, or Hispanics. We can see that the morbidity, again, across all ages is higher for kidney disease as well as for amputations. This shows you the difference by gender for black Americans and white Americans in the elder ages. Black American females that are older have a higher prevalence than white Americans, but contrast this to the experience of black American males, where you can see that at 75 and older, the prevalence is about the same. To me, this means that the males that were more fragile, had fewer poor access to health resources, died off, and you're left with a pretty robust group of elders 75 and older. For Hispanic Americans, and Ms. Alvarez will tell us more about this particular population in her presentation, in any event, like African Americans, diabetes is more prevalent. It's more prevalent in older Hispanics. And we know that in among Hispanics, it's a very, it's a lot of subdivisions within that ethnicity. So you think of Hispanics as being Puerto Rican Americans, Central Americans, people from Spain. But among that group, Mexican Americans, which is the largest Hispanic subgroup, are almost twice as likely to have diagnosed diabetes than U.S. non-Hispanic whites. As we saw before, for African Americans, there is a higher rate of kidney disease, and across the whole population, they're 1.5 times as likely to die from diabetes. Now remember, that first slide we saw about difference in mortality was restricted to the Medicare population. It is particularly concerning to me that approximately 1/3 of diabetes cases in Hispanic Americans are underdiagnosed or undiagnosed. Keep this in mind when you have your first encounter with an elder Hispanic American who may have not had access to care until their Medicare benefit kicked in. For Mexican Americans with diabetes, we see that they have higher rates of, or they have more severe hyperglycemia. And again, you've got that morbidity. You've got increased prevalence of diabetic retinopathy, that eye disease that severely limits vision and quality of life. Increased proteinuria, which means increased kidney problems. Again, dialysis can be have a huge impact on anyone, but particularly the elders. And we see this, again, noted that they have 6 times higher incidence of end-stage renal disease. I want to make note of a study that was done in Sacramento called the SALSA study, in which 1,789 Latinos aged 16 over were surveyed. They found that although the overall prevalence of dementia was about the same as non-Hispanic populations of the same age, it turned out that 43% of the patients with dementia had it attributable to diabetes, stroke, or a combination. Now keep in mind that dementia is not going to be an abrupt change necessarily in cognition. So as you see, your Mexican-American ethnic elder who's had diabetes for a while, think about the fact that they may be at higher risk of dementia. I wanted to also note that the health education level for patients, especially ethnic elders, may be quite variable. That same study, the SALSA study, found that almost half of the 1,800 older Latino elders had 8 years or less of formal education. This slide came from the prior webinar that we did last week, and in it you can see that the high school diploma or higher percentage of a 65-plus population varies quite a bit, going from 71% for non-Hispanic white to 65% for Asian Pacific Islander, 43% for non-Hispanic black, and 29% for the Hispanic population. What I have found in my own experience is that not only is literacy an issue for some ethnic elders, and my experience has been with first-generation Mexican elders, sometimes they are also innumerate, meaning that they count only using fingers. They may not have any meaning attached to written numbers. It becomes particularly challenging to talk to this particular cohort about lab values, insulin doses, and other numeric kinds of data. When you're trying to bridge the gap between you and that patient in front of you, it's helpful to know that for the Mexican elders, they may have value for personalismo, that personal relationship that you as a healthcare provider establish with your patient, especially showing respeto or respect to the elder in front of you. You can think about using familismo with the elder, in which you can bring the family in helping the elder cope with their diabetic diagnosis. Let's move to Native Hawaiians and Pacific Islanders. This data comes from mainly from people living in Hawaii, and we see that at least for people living in Hawaii, they were 2 times more likely to have been diagnosed with diabetes compared to white residents. In Hawaii, I believe that they have found that Native Hawaiians and Pacific Islanders are more than 3 times more likely to be diagnosed with diabetes, and they were less likely to have had a foot exam. They were much more likely to die from diabetes. So let's drill down a little bit about this notion of morbidity for our ethnic elders. Now, this slide is from Hawaii state data, and it's across all ages. But to give you an idea of the differential risk of patient populations, remember, retinopathy is a hugely significant factor in quality of life for everyone. But I would say that for elders, ethnic elders, it is even more of a handicap than for the younger population. It does affect elders more often. You can see that for the white population in Hawaii, about 16.5% had retinopathy. It goes all the way up to 28.7% for the Hawaiian population. Going from Pacific Islander and Hawaiians to Native Americans and American Indians and Alaska Natives, we see that same increase in likelihood that we've seen across African Americans, Hispanic Americans, Pacific Islanders. They're more likely to die from diabetes, and they're more likely to be diagnosed. It's interesting to me that at a regional level, diabetes is least common among Alaska Natives and most common among American Indians. For those of you familiar with this cohort, the Pima Indians are really the emblematic group with a high diabetes risk. More than 98% of diabetes in this American Indian Alaska Native population come from type 2 diabetes. And this slide just shows you again that differential rate of diabetes. I want you to always remember that within these monolithic ethnic groups, Hispanic American, African American, American Indian, Alaska Natives, they're made up of many smaller subgroups. And you need to be aware, if nothing else, that there can be huge variability within the subgroup. Those of you who are not practicing near a reservation may still be seeing American Indians and Alaska Natives. Remember that more than half of American Indians do not live on or near reservation land. The number of older American Indians is expected to nearly double between 2000 and 2020, and many of them live in urban areas. They often receive fragmented care from a variety of agencies. They may also not be comfortable in having their diabetes care done. They may have problems with the healthcare system and providers. They may have problems with the diabetes diagnosis, coping with depression, recognition of memory loss, and they often receive multiple sources of service that are not integrated. I included this slide to just show you a study where they found in interviewing elders that in fact they were those who were more closely identified with their indigenous culture were less adherent to diet, exercise, and medication use. It was interesting in this study that they found that actually medication adherence was higher than dietary adherence, due in part to utilizing medications to attenuate or to minimize dietary indiscretions. Among some of the traditional elders interviewed for this particular study, use of insulin was perceived as making one sicker. And I know from my own experience and in reviewing the literature, oftentimes use of insulin is associated with having more problems with your diabetes. That causal nexus between diabetes getting worse, requiring insulin, is somehow not adequately communicated by those of us on the healthcare team. This takes me to stereotypes versus generalizations. So we've just seen a few slides that give us some background information on American Indians American Indians and Native Alaskans. But you need to be careful, particularly those of you who are teaching other healthcare professional students about this, that you distinguish between stereotypes and generalization. For those of you who were in on the first webinar, we did go in depth about this. But basically, a stereotype provides an ending point, and it prevents you from finding out more about that patient in front of you. So, having heard about American Indians and their distrust of white medicine, you could just imagine the person in front of you who might be an American Indian ethnic elder distrust white medicine and take that as a stereotype. Generalizations are all about generating hypotheses that as healthcare professionals we vet with the person in front of us. So a generalization would be, this person in front of me is an American Indian, they're elderly, and I'm wondering what their beliefs are about having diabetes and being cared for in a traditional healthcare environment. Let me find out more about that before I proceed, because finding out more about that may help me provide better, more efficient care. There are a couple of slides here that about just different cultural beliefs around diabetes. Again, you'll get the slide set so you can read it more in depth. This was a study about Taiwanese diabetic patients' ideas of illness, where in which they found that diabetes was regarded as an incurable, inevitably deteriorating disorder of sugar metabolism with many chronic complications. This is another study where they did interviews with white Pakistani and Indian respondents in the United Kingdom. Pakistani and Indian respondents in this particular study highlighted their life circumstances in general and their experience of migrating to Britain to account for their diabetes, and then white respondents had a different take on the situation. In addition to cultural variation in terms of cultural beliefs, I put this slide in to remind all of us that there are also pharmacologic and biochemical differences for ethnic elders. So all of you are probably aware that being elderly means that you may respond to medication differently. In addition, different ethnicities respond differently to different medications. So keep that in mind as well. I think we'll be getting a lot more data about how to take this into account with individual patients as the era of personalized medicine develops. We're still very, very early in that era. So let's talk about what the guidelines would be for improving the care of the older person with diabetes. We talked briefly about the importance of screening for cognitive impairment. We want to make recommendations for management of risk factors. Talk about maintaining the appropriate level of hemoglobin A1C. Keep in mind that a number value may not have relevance for somebody who is enumerate. We want culturally and linguistically appropriate methods of diabetes education. But let's go back to that screen for depression. What we know is that depression is more common in general in people with diabetes. We also know that older adults have a high rate of underdiagnosis and undertreatment of their depressive symptoms. Depressed older adults with diabetes incur higher non-mental health costs than those who are not depressed. And there are poor outcomes of diabetes care for patients with unrecognized depression. If you're not in the habit of thinking about depression for your patients with diabetes, please start doing so, particularly the elders who may already be underdiagnosed. A comprehensive evaluation might also include social and economic history, family health history, physical exam, all these other things. I want to just highlight that for social and economic history, for those of you who were online for our last webinar 1 week ago, we talked about the Stanford Geriatric Education Center's cohort analysis approach to finding out more about ethnic elders. For those of you who were not online, please go to our website and look up cohort analysis. And a nice way of integrating that into a social history is to ask the ethnic elder, where did you spend your childhood, or where did you grow up? Again, we do not want our patients to feel like they're being queried about whether or not they are citizens, whether or not they are legal, but it's just a gentle inquiry about where they spent their childhood that can help you with cohort analysis. Emergency preparedness is something that I think most of us never give a thought to. Hurricane Katrina taught us all some hard lessons about ethnic elders and their ability to be prepared for emergencies. As you think about your ethnic elder diabetic patients, again, with visual deficits, perhaps cognitive deficits, perhaps ambulatory challenges, keep in mind that they need to be aware of what they would do in case there was an emergency. On the prior slide, we saw that we wanted to talk about attitude towards diabetes treatment and management. And this little study here I put in just to validate that, in fact, when they've studied medication possession ratio, which is a proxy for medication adherence, in fact, medication possession ratio was significantly lower for this cohort among non-Hispanic blacks, Hispanics, and individuals with other missing or unknown race or ethnicity. So again, validation that for this particular population, in fact, there was a difference based on ethnicity about medication adherence. Don't make this a stereotype. Use it as a hypothesis. Find out more about that patient in front of you. Nutrition is huge with our diabetic patients, and something that Carolyn Fee, who is in our original Stanford Geriatric Education Center core faculty, taught me was that breakfast choices provide the most evidence of dietary acculturation. So if you don't have much time, again, I don't want you to go into all of this stuff with the first encounter you have with your ethnic elder with diabetes. All of this develops with that continuity relationship you have with your patient. So along the way, do have a conversation about what they have for breakfast. Help them to make healthy food choices. Focus on a return to healthy traditional foods. With the advent of the Western diet for many indigenous populations, we see a huge increase in type 2 diabetes. All of us were genetically programmed way back when with our ancestors many generations ago. Eating healthy traditional foods often will decrease that truncal obesity. Control food portions and teach serving sizes. I don't know if Ms. Alvarez will go into it, but Kate Lorig, who works with her, talks about the plate method. The plate method means that when you look at a dinner plate, divide it in half, fill half with vegetables, fill a quarter with your protein, and fill a quarter with your complex carbohydrate. It's a real simple way to think about controlling food portions and teaching serving sizes, even if somebody is innumerate. These are some dietary interventions that you can look at your leisure. I wanted to include this slide for those of you who think that dietary interventions are obvious. This was a nice study in which they looked at Muslims and how to prepare them through patient education for Ramadan if they were type 2 diabetics. The aim of this study was to determine the impact of Ramadan-focused education on weight and hypoglycemic, that is, low blood sugar episodes, during Ramadan in a type 2 diabetic Muslim population. And they found that, in fact, Ramadan-focused education can empower patients to change their lifestyle. How great it would be for those of you who have significant numbers of Muslim elder patients to incorporate this in your outreach to them. So we've talked a lot. We've kind of gone through a whirlwind of my ideas about how we can tailor our diabetic care to the individual patient. For those of you who are not familiar with the overarching paradigm for best practice in chronic illness care, please go to this website. The chronic care model remains today in America the best practice for taking care of populations of our diabetic patients. This was developed by Ed Wagner, who remains active in this research. It starts with having ties to community and the health systems, and you can see all the various things that are involved in the community and health system. It funnels down to an informed, activated patient having productive interactions with a prepared, proactive practice team to have improved outcomes for all patients with chronic illness. So how do you layer on taking care of an ethnic elder population onto this chronic care model? I would suggest that you incorporate the LEARN mnemonic in implementing the chronic care model for all members of that healthcare team. This was developed at Stanford in 1983 and has been well validated and has spread to most healthcare settings. It starts with listening with sympathy and understanding to the patient's perception of the problem. Then you can explain your perception of the problem. You acknowledge and discuss the differences and similarities. You can recommend treatment, but then you negotiate on agreement so that it's based on well-validated precepts of cultural negotiation and interacting with patients. And the only twist I have is that you have your chronic disease, chronic care model hat on with that informed, activated patient, and you want to be a member of a prepared, proactive practice team. Kick it up a notch by layering on that LEARN mnemonic with your ethnic elders. So for diagnosis, treatment, and management that is culturally appropriate or sensitive or done with cultural humility for our ethnic elders, we want culturally and language appropriate education. We want to use as much as possible bilingual professionals, community leaders to help spread the word. Include information on relationship between calories, metabolism, and diabetes control in a way that is accessible for all of your ethnic elder patients, regardless of literacy or numeracy. Large print literature, remember, retinopathy is a very significant complication for our diabetic elders. Ethnic-specific languages, we want it to be community-based, if possible, church-based, providing emotional and psychological support. We want ongoing intervention with education on self-management, updates on state-of-the-art treatment option, and long-term support and counseling. And with this slide, I'd like to turn it over to my colleague, Sonia Alvarez.
Good afternoon to all of you. My name is Sonia Alvarez, and I'll be your second presenter for this webinar. The first three topics as listed in this slide related to my presentation will be around the Spanish Diabetes Self-Management Program developed by Dr. Kay Lorig and her research team at the Stanford Patient Education Research Center. I'll summarize the main outcomes of the randomized trial, and remember that this is the trial that originated the program that now is being disseminated through the world, actually. And I also will summarize the main characteristics of what has been known now to be the Stanford model for self-management of chronic conditions. The second part of my presentation, however, will be less scientific. It will be more an informal sharing of my thoughts and experiences about cultural competence and what that means for healthcare professionals in pursuit of better understanding with their patients, particularly with the Latinos and elder Latinos. These opinions stem from a blending of personal experiences as a Latina immigrant, also as a patient with diabetes, and as a community health educator who has taught and trained hundreds of Latinos with diabetes. So as most Stanford programs, the Spanish Diabetes Self-Management Program, the name in Spanish is Manejo Personal de la Diabetes, is offered in series of 6 sessions, 1 per week for 6 weeks, and each session lasts for about 2.5 hours. It was designed to be a community-based program to be offered in places that are close and familiar to patients who take it, and basically in their own communities. It was also designed to be facilitated by peer leaders after these peer leaders are trained and certified by master trainers who have also been trained and have had experience facilitating workshops in the community and have been certified by Stanford. The program content meets the standards of both the American Diabetes Association and the American Association of Diabetes Educators. Some of the topics covered during those 6 weeks are monitoring of glucose, healthy eating, exercise, stress management, how to deal with difficult emotions, communication skills, prevention of complications, and working with your healthcare professionals. Some of these topics are repeated with slight variations throughout the 6 weeks, and some are presented just once. Let's take a look at how the Stanford programs are developed, and one of them, of course, is this, the Diabetes Self-Management Program. It is important to stress that our programs are evidence-based. They have been developed systematically from need assessments from people with diabetes and from experts' knowledge, and then evaluated through randomized trials. The program content and methods are carefully scripted into manuals that are then used by leaders and trainers to deliver the program in the community or to train leaders and train other trainers. In addition, the Stanford programs utilize participatory techniques, methods, and techniques to increase self-efficacy, which I will describe next. All the current Stanford programs rest on the theoretical principles of Dr. Albert Bandura, widely known social cognitive theory, and the construct self-efficacy. Dr. Bandura, by the way, is still faculty at Stanford, and his theory postulates that the drive of individuals, all of us, to exercise control over events that affect our lives, paired with confidence in the abilities to take action and overcome barriers, result in changes in health behaviors. Some of the techniques that are used to enhance self-efficacy are embedded throughout the Stanford programs. In addition, there are other very important assumptions that underlie our programs, and these are, number one, that people with diabetes share concerns and problems. The disease may manifest differently in different individuals, but as people with diabetes, we all share concerns and problems. Second, the person with diabetes must deal not only with the disease and the management of that disease, but also with the emotional impact that the disease has on their lives. Third, lay people with diabetes, when given a detailed manual, can facilitate the program as effectively, if not more effectively sometimes, than health professionals. And we'll be exploring and looking at this later in my presentation. And the fourth assumption is that the process of teaching diabetes self-management is often more important than the subject or the information that is given to them. But where is the evidence? The evidence that this program is effective, that is really improves people's lives. The randomized trial was sponsored by the National Institute of Nursing Research and was conducted for a period of about 5 years with a total ending number of 533 participants. Data was collected at baseline at 6 months and 18 months intervals. Then compared with a usual care group, participants in the intervention groups improve their health status, health behaviors, and their self-efficacy. They also had fewer emergency room visits. At 1 year, in fact, I have to clarify, at 18 months, the improvements were maintained in 5 of 7 indicators. So what are the implications for clinicians given the previous outcomes and characteristics of this program, the diabetes self-management program? The results from our research, we can expect that certainly not all of them, but for a good number of patients that participate in such program for health education to be better managers and be more aware of the realities of their disease. They will know that their doctors cannot cure them and will likely be more confident in their abilities to make changes that benefit themselves and their families. Certainly, there is a potential to form a true partnership with your patients once they have gone through a program like this, and there is this potential of developing this partnership with your patients available to providers, healthcare providers, to explore deeper. There is also a potential for savings in healthcare costs. Cost analysis, I must say, was not part of the study, but we can infer that better managed diabetes patients and less emergency room and healthcare utilization may result in significant savings. So allow me to share, before I get in more extend into this slide, why with you some of my most important learning from my theory class when I was in the MPH program. My theory professor, Dr. Radelfinger, he's no longer at San Jose State, but I was lucky enough to have him as a professor of the theory class. Referring to working with patients or participants, whatever you want to call them, clients, he often said, don't ask why they don't do the things that you want them to do. Rather, ask yourself, why do they do the things they do? And this thought has been with me since then, and I think it's relevant to what we're talking about as far as working with Latino population and attaining that understanding of different cultures. The very first step, I think, in approaching cross-cultural relationships is to understand that everything that we see and hear may and usually has a totally different meaning than the one we attach to it as professionals or as individuals. Because despite our claims of being neutral, we are also influenced by our own set of beliefs and interpretations. The second step is to understand that meaning is relative. Even what we may consider to be undisputed evidence may still have different meanings or even no meaning to some people. Of course, it's easier said than done, right? Even if we hold this conviction, I know that I do, but we struggle with this sometimes in our practices. I think this is part of living in a multicultural society. In this part of my presentation, I'm going to look at five macro areas. I believe they are important to consider as we approach cultural competence and sensitivity. It's not so much an issue of professional preparation, like we go to school and we learn a subject and then we feel that we are empowered with that. It's more a process. It's an issue of being aware of the existence of different realities, the realities that can be different from ours. At a minimum, our goal should be avoiding mistakes in judgment and avoid stereotyping. And ideally, we would like to find effective solutions to the problems of understanding and communicating cross-culturally and have enriching relationships with the people we serve. In the title of this slide, you see the spiced adjective. And this title comes from the controversial nature of some of the issues that I'm going to be naming and exploring here. And many of us rather do not talk about things like this, but I think it is important to look at them. So let's start with immigration issues at the political and economic level. As professionals, we should not ignore the impact of the immigration experience at the social, political, and economic level. In California particularly, not exclusively, but in California particularly and the Southwest, there is a rich history of U.S.-Mexico relations with ample incidents of inequality and unfairness. And if all history is not our cup of tea, we don't have to go further than the present. This is a time when we can see a multiplicity of efforts across our country against perceived illegal immigrants with a complete disregard in many cases to basic human rights. Regardless of our political stance, we are all part of the same economic system. And we are part of economic gains or losses of the immigration phenomenon. Therefore, we might consider to take a look at the big picture, if not for value or ethical reasons, at least for practical reasons that will impact any programs for health education, advertisement, recruitment, allocation of resources, etc. But let's assume that we are ready to serve the immigrant population, the documented or the undocumented immigrant. The main set of questions is in regards to the immigrant Latino elder population is, who are they? What's their background? What do they believe? What makes their lives easier or difficult? What facilitates or gets in the way of their self-management efforts? Particularly for undocumented immigrants, being invisible means exactly that. They are invisible, even when it is you or me with our good intentions who are looking for them. So another look at immigration is from a psychosocial perspective. Similarly, we should be sensitive to the potential and real impact of the migratory experience in people's emotional well-being. We heard in the previous presentation about the big problem of depression. Leaving your country of origin, regardless of the reasons for leaving or the circumstances in which you left, for most people and for most of the time, it is a traumatic experience. Acculturation is not easy. For Latino elders participating in self-management program, the goal for that is not just to become good self-managers of their condition, it's also about becoming empowered within unfamiliar environments and unfamiliar medical system, and oftentimes within their own families that are going through acculturation themselves. And if on top of that you add limited resources, financial resources, it can be very difficult. For undocumented immigrants and families, the fear of deportation adds another emotional layer of stress and worry in their lives. The next topic is multiculturalism, social, economic, political, cultural realities. Hispanics or Latin Americans may speak the same language, but we are not a homogeneous community. The United States is not a homogeneous either. Our self-management workshops that we offer, for example, in the U.S.-Mexico border towns or cities are not the same as those offered in Florida or in Chicago, New York, Fresno, California. They vary slightly from place to place. Migratory groups are different due to differences in countries of origin, political realities of those countries, and their relationship with the U.S. Even migration laws and programs are different for different groups. Even from the same country, different groups may have very different migratory experiences. Take Cuba, for example, where I am from. There have been several very different waves of migration in the last 50 years. My migration experience in the 70s, for example, had little to do with the massive exodus of Cubans who left through the port of Mariel in the early 80s. Next is the difference between what we consider cultural or class related. I have found that it's fairly common to explain behaviors we observe as being cultural, when in fact the explanation of those behaviors has more to do with socioeconomic status. While it is true that many cultural patterns influence behavior, for instance, you may say that in general Latinos enjoy eating, or eating is part of the culture, and in general our diets tend to be high in carbohydrates. I would agree with all of that. However, the quality of what we eat has more to do with economics rather than culture. I often hear people say Latinos do not eat vegetables and they will never eat vegetables. Well, that may not be so true. It's not true either that when given options for healthy eating, like the ones I have expressed before, they will all refuse them. That has been our experience at all with the classes that we teach in the community. Where I live, for example, in the middle class, Latinos may go to a small local farmers markets for fruits and vegetables. Low-income Latinos buy them at La Pulga, that is the flea market in San Jose. Another example is limited internet access. It's not a cultural rejection of an impersonal mechanism of communication, because that's against the Latino culture. It has to do more with low academics, cost of computer equipment, and lower exposure to new technology. Socioeconomic status, not so much cultural practices, determine how much and the quality of information we receive, where we go for health care, if we go at all, and how we deal with depression. And last, some thoughts about trust and personalismo. We saw that this concept introduced in the previous presentation. From recruitment, registration, and education of program participants to perhaps building intercollaboration with other community agencies serving the same population, trust is central to program success. Trust translates into being truthful in all aspects of the interaction. It includes words and actions. Particularly with undocumented immigrants, the issue of trust is central. This is probably one of the main reasons for promotoras de salud or community health workers to be so effective, because people trust them. They see themselves in them and respond to their genuine concerns. Personalismo, as we saw, has been identified by others as the high value Latinos put into personal relations and social interaction. The medical encounter is not an exception for that. As health professional, you may measure your success in terms of your ability to cure or alleviate your patient's suffering, or even the quality of your service. But keep in mind that from the perspective of many of your Latino patients, particularly elders, being perceived as a good person is often the measure of a good doctor. And now to wrap up my presentation, don't be scared about the 6 points. It's not going to take that long. I would like to offer you some closing comments. The first of them is posing a question. What is a strictly clinical? Without minimizing the importance of medicine in our lives and the unique contribution of our doctors and other health professionals when we are ill, we need to recognize that the medical encounter, particularly when dealing with chronic diseases, constitute a minimal part of the healing process. We know that individuals living with chronic conditions not only manage their disease, but manage the other roles in their lives. We are parents, friends, neighbors, workers, in addition to the emotional impact of the disease that we also need to deal with. Understanding the socio-cultural nature of what otherwise may be thought as clinical is then necessary to arrive at realistic and effective interactions. The next one is that information is not enough. When it comes to chronic diseases, particularly diabetes, we know that understanding the biomedical dynamics of the disease is not enough. It may actually be a deterrent for an individual to take action. Our research has demonstrated that an educational process that expands people's knowledge about their disease with only giving them the information that is most critical for them to know. When you have a process that promotes active engagement, that creates an environment for self-determination, that allows self-tailoring of different management options, and an environment that feels safe and is free of blame, returns more engaged participants in their own care. On average, they not only know more, but do more. Also, the process takes priorities, and the issue of awareness, which I mentioned before, is not so much what we do, but how we do it, that may be critical in a multicultural society and the chronic nature of diseases. Assuming the quality of clinical care is intact, we must recognize that the relationship between provider and patient must include social, cultural, and anthropological perspective when better quality of the medical encounter is our goal. For health professionals, this means going outside the traditional biomedical model. We saw the chronic care model presented before, and becoming aware of different realities that serve as context or sometimes even sources of explanation of what otherwise we may think are irrational behavior in patients. Again, the process takes priority, and the communication, language, and linguistics. We know that language conveys much more than words. for those of you who know more than one language, you know that when you speak in one particular language, you also need to think in that language. So the world of linguistics can help us tremendously in our search for better communication. We did not have the time today to explore that, but I'm certainly not the qualified person to speak on that topic, but all I know is that the field of linguistics and cross-cultural communications can aid us in understanding how much of what happens during the medical encounter can be understood and improved by looking at conversational styles or what the linguistics call meta messages, that is, what is not said during a conversation. I cannot stress enough the unique contributions of promotoras de salud or peer health promoters. Community health workers is another way to call them. Community health workers, as promotoras de salud is the primary way that they are referred to in Mexico and other Latin American countries, but mainly in Mexico. We have found that when properly trained and nurtured, contribute to the success of a self-management and community health education process and program. Promotoras do require, however, careful selection and ongoing support. But if you're truly interested in empowerment in health education of Latinos, you must have an established group of promotoras in place. They are not simply a low-cost replacement for other health professionals. Their contributions are as unique as the contributions of professionals. Sometimes even they surpass them. And my last but not less important closing comment has to do with bilingual and bicultural personnel. When working with hard-to-reach populations or the invisible groups, different resources are required. In my experience working with Latinos, I have found that what you may think is a simple question or a straightforward conversation end up taking a lot more time. And efforts towards cultural competence must include professionals and lay workers from the same culture or population of those that we intend to serve. Or the other alternative is for English speakers, professionals to become fluent in Spanish and be knowledgeable of Latino cultures. And with that, I conclude my presentation. Thank you very much. Here's our website where a lot of information about our programs can be found. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sonia. This is Nancy Morioka-Douglas again. I just wanted to respond to with my thoughts about points that Sonia had made. First of all, I'm thinking that for those of you in the audience, you may be thinking, wow, that's a lot of information. How do I possibly integrate it into my everyday practice, either as a health care provider or as a trainer of health care providers? The strategy that I would advise you consider is to look for those high-yield opportunities to apply this information. For many of you working with diabetic elders, you have access to your chronic disease registries. For those of you not familiar with the concept, it is possible to get a list of all patients with diabetes that you care for, and with columns with a date of birth, perhaps ethnicity, perhaps primary care provider, perhaps with lab values. So then you can sort, and I would sort for elders with perhaps high hemoglobin A1Cs that would provide you with the opportunity to then apply what you learned today to target those people for whom you might be able to get their very high hemoglobin A1Cs to not so bad hemoglobin A1Cs. Another strategy would be to look at your ethnic elder patients or clients who have recently been hospitalized, particularly those with repeated hospitalization. Use your new awareness and knowledge that you learned today to help think about different ways of intervening with them. Finally, we've talked a lot about complications from diabetes.
those elders with vision problems, kidney failure, amputation, or risk of amputation are a great population to systematically apply lessons learned. Specifically, we've talked a lot about a variety of interventions that can be done. I know that for those of you who are experienced in taking care of the diabetic population of all ages, you know how to do a lot of this. But for our elders, you want to be sure that you think about cognitive impairment and screening for it so you pick it up early. You want to screen for depression. And I would encourage you to think about how you assess the ability for that ethnic elder to respond if there is an emergency. Always think about developing hypotheses for this patient population and then testing them to see if, in fact, they hold up when you talk to your ethnic elder individual patient. Sonia has given us just a great context for her spiced up cultural sensitivity. She had focused on the Hispanic immigrant elder, and from my work and the work at the Stanford Geriatric Education Center, it's really important to think about the wave of migration that your elder patient came in on. What we know for many populations is that first wave, the wave that happened probably 20 to 30 years ago, that first wave of ethnic elders who come in are often well-educated and from a higher socioeconomic background. There may not be as many barriers in taking care of them as the more recent waves, the second and third waves, where you get the less well-educated, the people that come from lower SES from their home country. One of the ways that you can quickly assess what wave of immigrant you are seeing is to do a quick cohort analysis. And again, for those of you who missed out on the first webinar, you can find this on our Stanford Geriatric Education Center website. Keep in mind that some of your ethnic elders are followers of children. They have adult children in America who ask that they come out to help care for grandchildren, or maybe because the adult children are worried that the ethnic elder would not be able to manage as well in their country of origin. Sonia talks about the fact that for chronic conditions, you're not only managing the disease, but managing all the other roles this patient has in their life. Certainly for followers of children, many of whom are may have linguistic barriers, many of whom are isolated at home, there are special challenges to consider in helping to get their diabetes under control. Thank you very much. And now I'll turn it over to Chris Motola.
Thank you, Dr. Morioka-Douglas and Ms. Alvarez. We now have some time for the presenters to answer your questions. If you have any questions, please use the chat feature. It is located on the lower left side of your screen. After the Q&A or during, we would like you each ask each of the participants to answer the short evaluation questionnaire you will find on this slide at Stanford University Qualtrics, and a very long thing, but I'm not going to repeat. We will now turn to the questions that participants have asked. Feel free to ask at any time.
So since I don't see, I see some chat, but I don't see any questions, I would just ask Ms. Alvarez, from your perspective, what were the barriers that you encountered in working in your chronic disease self-management groups with the Latino population, and were there any lessons learned that you can share with us? I think, you know, most of us doing a lot of work in chronic disease management realize that the answer does not lie in one patient and one healthcare provider in one exam room. More and more we're going to group approaches.
In our experience and the experience that I hear from different groups in different states across the country, one of the main barriers, or let's say challenges for them, is recruitment. And as you will recall in my presentation, I talked about the invisible populations, and with certain populations, this is a big problem, where to find the participants for those workshops. And so it's a challenge, but it can be solved by using a variety of promotion techniques, and sometimes being very creative with the ways of how to recruit, go to health fairs and where the population gathers. I mentioned La Pulga here, the flea market, where a lot of Latinos goes on weekends, and so the announcements in newspapers or Latino radio and TV, a number of things need to be explored that will work in certain locations more than others. But answering your question, Nancy, is really more about recruitment, how to get the people first, and then the program itself will take care of maintaining them in the classes. There's a question here about how might diabetes education work in the frail nursing home population. I know of many places where the classes actually are planned and take place at nursing homes. Now, this on one hand may solve the problem of accessing them, because they most likely won't be able to go to other places, and so having the class right there may seem as a solution to that problem. However, there are some other challenges, because there are certain schedules that may interfere with the classes, or so again, being creative around that, or coordinating the classes very well with the person in charge at the nursing home is very important. But I have heard that has been a very, very good solution to that problem. And the participation is often higher, because they spread the word. And some people that may go to a class and not to the other, they will talk about it because they all live there. And so it ends up, it could be a very good option. There's okay, Nancy, how do you find out about classes in other ethnic communities? You mean other than not your own community? I'm not sure about what other ethnic communities are referring here, other than Hispanic. From practice in the field, I have to admit, other experience in working with other populations. But what comes as a natural response is go to where members of this population gather. It can be a place where the people go to eat, or they go shopping. Churches have been, for Latinos and I bet for many other cultural groups, is another place where you know where to find them. that's when the issue, what I mentioned about promotoras, becomes very important, because it's totally different hearing from, and even if you have past participants in a class that go and do the recruitment, or a very short presentation, it can be 10 minutes or even less, people will most likely respond to that than a more formal approach from a professional. So go to where people are, where people naturally gather. If you want men in for your groups, that's a big challenge. Most of our groups are attended by women. So where do you find men? Well, you know, sometimes when there are soccer games and they gather in certain places, so that's where you do your... So it's just responding to...
I think, Sonia, that maybe Nancy was asking about knowing who else is providing these self-management classes, and I see a question from Maria Nava about how does one become a trained and certified peer leader. For all those questions, I think best that they go to your website, because I believe on your website, and that's patienteducation.stanford.edu, on that website, you'll find a list of the different courses that are, or different groups that are being offered across the country and around the world, as well as a lot more information on becoming a trained and certified peer leader.
This is Chris Mottola at the Stanford GEC. This concludes our presentation today on topics in diabetes. I'd like to thank the presenters, Dr. Morioka-Douglas and Ms. Alvarez. If you enjoyed this presentation, please be aware that completion of the survey above allows us to continue to get funding. Thank you so much for your participation. Our next webinar in the series will be on Thursday, April 14th at the same time. It will be on depression and mental health and presented by Drs. Dolores Gallagher-Thompson and Rita Hargrave. Thank you.